it looks like illegal immigration isn't just a problem for the U.S., and oil spills aren't really limited to the ocean. Apparently, they can happen in the middle of a city, Los Angeles. Hey, guys, welcome to the Dimcat channel. It's May 15th, 2014. I'm Reginald, also known as Dimcat. I'm going to talk about some of the things going on around the country. First, Los Angeles, there was actually an oil spill. The fire department is now saying that it's somewhere around 50,000 gallons of oil. And no, it wasn't BP. It was actually Plains All American pipeline. They had a problem with one of their pumps or whatever, and the oil just went out all over the place, shot up like 40 feet up in the air. It's got me thinking, like, if we have to worry so much about these terrorists who are going to attack us all the time, and we have such a delicate infrastructure, how come we're not getting more attacks? I've always wondered about that, you know? You know, I think a lot of you already know the answer to it, okay? Like, but I just want to throw that out there, okay? Other things going on across the country, Detroit, the art. I was very concerned about what was going to happen to the art. Well, a federal judge dealing with the Detroit bankruptcy situation came out and said that, hey, you know what? The creditors and the bond insurers, they cannot get their hands on the art, like physically on the art. Now, some of this art is sort of valued somewhere around maybe $470 to about $870 million. Some people, especially on Wall Street, think it's actually worth more money. And we'll see how the good news here is that they're not going to be able to physically touch it. Basically, the judge said that if you guys want to check out this art, you got to look at it and go by the same rules as any other person just going into the art museums. And I've been to the Detroit Institute of Arts a couple of times, and the place is absolutely wonderful, and I hope they hold on to that art. I hope they don't lose that art because of stupid obligations or stupid promises they made in regards to pensions. Hey, you know, they're going to have to take some cuts in those pensions. And speaking of which, the National Strike Day, France. Now, their prime minister is struggling, the Socialist Party are struggling to get their economy going. Big surprise. I mean, the Socialist Party struggling to get the economy going. Okay. Yeah, well, they had a National Strike Day there. You had people demonstrating. The public employees are demonstrating there. And, well, they demonstrated there. And the Prime Minister is trying to freeze a lot of the public employees' pay, which means that they won't get increases every single year. Well, at some point, they're gonna have to do something. They had zero growth in France for their economy in the first quarter of this year. And Germany, meanwhile, had 0.8% growth, which isn't really that great, but zero growth for France. You know, I don't think the National Strike Day is going to really be a big part of the solution. The problem is that a lot of these public employees, they're not, especially in France, they're not looking at the simple fact that governments can't really do anything without private entities, private companies actually creating something, creating wealth, and creating something out of that. Then that's when the governments come in and tax that and take a piece of that, and they're able to actually provide funding for people. You know, it's only when the private entities actually create jobs that they're able to do that. Well, speaking of private entities, Chicago. There were protests on the National Strike Day in Chicago, and apparently some of these people are asking, some of these fast food workers are asking for $15 an hour. That's not realistic, okay? I think we need more jobs in this country that pay a living wage, something you can actually live off of. But I don't think that every job necessarily has to pay a living wage. Some of these jobs are just better suited for, teenagers getting their first job. I don't think it's necessary for people to make $15 an hour at McDonald's. I don't think that model could really work. You know, I mean, hell, they'll be getting paid more money than I am, you know, and they'll just be flipping burgers. I've been in situations where I made very, very small amounts of money, and I gotta tell you that I do think we do need more jobs that are centered towards production, and those jobs are gonna be able to pay people a living wage. But I don't think the solution is to try to strong arm corporations in the fast food industry to try to pay living wages. The economics just aren't there. They're just not there. It's not going to work out. Okay, what else is going on? European Union, they actually had about, as far as illegal immigration, they actually had about 110,000 detections, people trying to get into the country. In 2013, that was an increase over about 70-something thousand people. trying to get into the European Union illegally in 2012. And a lot of this has to do with changes in world events, such as what's going on in Syria, which isn't a big surprise. So basically, the Europeans can thank us for that little involvement right there. another thing that really jumped out of my head, D.C., Washington, D.C. Now, you know, in 2008, they were basically told recently that they can't have a gun ban in the city. It's unconstitutional. I always thought it was kind of ironic that here you had a capital of our country, and you had politicians trying to tell people that they didn't have Second Amendment rights in the capital. I always thought that was ironic. But anyway, a federal judge actually said that recently that their registration requirements for gun owners were constitutional, and they basically upheld that. I thought that was really interesting. Basically, they had to register, get photographed, get fingerprinted, take these safety classes. I'm thinking like, okay, I gotta get photographed and I gotta get registered and fingerprinted. I mean, what am I, a child molester or something? I mean, come on. You know, this is basically what you have to do if you're a sex offender. So, like, why would you do that to gun owners? I don't think it's right to say, okay, you're a gun owner. You got to register all your guns every three years, and you got to give us your fingerprints. Like, you did something wrong, man. It's, yeah. I always thought that was kind of interesting, because it's not like, okay, if I was a bad guy, I was going to, it's not like I'm going to go up to a city, police department and register my guns before I bust a cap in somebody's ass. I mean, come on. I mean, really, I'm gonna register my guns before I rob a liquor store? Doesn't make a lot of sense there. But hey, that's just how I view it. Another thing that doesn't make a lot of sense, in Minnesota, they actually required, they became the first state to actually require people to, well, actually require companies to put an anti-theft tracking system, a kill switch in cell phones and tablets, which I thought was kind of weird. Why would you require something like that? I think the market should decide that. Why don't you just let companies offer a certain type of models that do that, you know, and let them offer devices that don't do it. You know, let people buy whatever they want to buy, okay? I don't know why the government has to step in and say, oh, we're going to require you to do this as an anti-theft measure. Well, okay, an anti-theft measure? Here's the thing. This could be abused by a government if you have a situation where more states are passing laws like this and people are sort of required to use this anti-theft kill switch in their devices. You know, what if there's some information getting out that the government doesn't want people to have, and they start shutting down people's laptops and stuff? I know to a lot of you guys, it's like, oh man, that's never going to happen. Well, why do you need to require companies to have a kill switch in the first place? Doesn't really make a lot of sense. All right. So anyway, guys, share your thoughts. Tell me what you think. I've been thinking a lot about something called the K-wave. Now, the whole idea behind this is that we sort of go through these phases of summer where, you know, it's a big boom economically. There's sort of a higher inflation, but you have good economic times. You have the summer, which you have sort of like a peak. You have even higher double-digit inflation. And then you have August, where you have a season where you have a fake plateau. You have an extension of credit. You have a credit boom, and you have a lot of speculation. And then, of course, you have the winter when things sort of deflate, and you deal with the consequences of of that cycle coming to an end. You have a sort of like a depression. Well, a lot of people speculate that towards the end of that cycle, you have a war, and then after that war, you start off with spring all over again. You sort of have that cycle. You have, you know, this, you have this depression, then you have this war, then you have another spring where you have an economic expansion. And you sort of see that in sort of like the population trends as well. It's interesting. You have the big baby boomer population, the big generation of people who came after World War II, because a lot of people had kids after World War II, and we now call those people that came right after World War II the baby boomer population. Well, there's such a big demographic block that when you look at all the next generations that come up behind them, they're much smaller. So what that means is that when you have all these people, these baby boomers trying to retire and trying to use these government programs and stuff like that, you're going to have a much smaller population of their children trying to contribute to that system. And the only way that system can really remain solvent is if it was fundamentally set up right as a solvent system. But I would argue that a lot of these programs like Social Security are set up like Ponzi schemes. And that's why when you have a smaller group of people contributing to it, you know, that's why you're going to have problems. Now, we'll see what really happens, but I think it's something worth talking about. Tell me what you guys think about the K-wave. Tell me about your thoughts on the demographics and how it's going to affect our economy and our way of life here in America. Thanks for watching again. Don't forget, the future belongs to those who prepare for it today. Bye.